Goyf's four Death Shadows. I mean, unless you're counting Street Wraith as a creature.
Which I wouldn't.
I start wondering then, is it, you know, how hard is it for Obsidian just to kill spell Matt out of the game?
You have access to plenty of clean answers. There's three Path to Exile, two Fatal Push in the main deck, two Abrupt Decay as well, three Liliana of the Veil, a Maelstrom Pulse. It's not terribly difficult to just kill all of these creatures. Nas does have access to a copy of Liliana, the Last Hope, which can be used to recur these creatures.
Okay. One Liliana's Last Hope and one Liliana of the Veil. So Matt has a split of the two Planeswalkers.
Mm-hmm. This is another thing on the deck red sheet where Johnson has an advantage. He has creature lands, whereas Nas just has a bunch of lands that tap for mana.
And you see, Matt thought really hard about the land to fetch there. Ended up going for basic Swamp to Fatal Push down the Confidant. Even with that deck, it can be tricky because even when you don't need the second color, sometimes you just actually want to deal two to yourself.
Right. You kind of evaluate your resources. How much damage do you have to take just to play the game? Where does that put your Death Shadows? How much does managing your Death Shadow to be the most powerful matter? And against a deck like a regular traditional Obzon deck, the game is likely to go long. You don't want to necessarily do too much damage to yourself.
So Brendan tries a turn two play, meets a kill spell. Now Matt will try the same. It's going to be Tarmogoyf. And then a copy of Mizra's Bauble. So the Tarmogoyf currently with creature, land, and instant in the graveyard is a 3-4. Matt can make it a 4-5 at will with the, thanks to that Mizra's Bauble. But Brendan's answers are clean. They don't care about toughness. You know, Abrupt Decay, Liliana of the Veil, Fatal Push, Path to Exile. None of those care what Tarmogoyf's size is.
You see Nas keeping his Mishra's Bauble on the battlefield for this turn, likely signaling that he has a fetch land in his hand and he wants to possibly filter his draw that way, look at the top card, decide if he wants to shuffle it away or not.
Okay, so he'd have to, that means he'd have to use it another turn down the road, just leaving a fetch in play.
Mm. He could also just wait for the context of what Johnson does this turn and then look at the top card of Johnson's deck to inform his decisions for his following turn.
Johnson's going to play a Thought Seize. We'll get a look at Matt's hand. Teemer Battle Rage, Kolaghan's Command, and Godless Shrine.
And not surprising to see the Kolaghan's Command hit the bin there.
No, just trade cards, trade cards. That's Brendan's plan.
Yep. The Battle Rage, assuming you're able to manage the battlefield, is really just a functional mulligan.
Yeah, and that's one of the scarier parts here. Matt will end step just go ahead and get rid of that Bauble. Looking at Brendan's top card. Now, Brendan has left up two mana, but it does have enough to cast the Abrupt Decay in his hand. Mm-hmm. Death's Shadow, a pickup for Matt Nass. You notice Matt down a card here. He did mulligan to six this game. Tarmogoyf will swing, but it is abruptly put into the graveyard. And Matt can replace the threat with Death Shadow. And it looks like a second Death Shadow. His last card is Teemer Battle Rage with both players no. The Shadows are now 1/1s.
And with Johnson being on Abzan instead of Jund, these won't die to Lightning Bolt.
Yeah, it's 3/3s. Matt did Shock for Godless Shrine there, so certainly important when you look at the Collective Brutality in Brendan's hand.
Yeah. All that can really do right now is take away the Teemer Battle Rage that Johnson already knows about, which might be worth doing.
Yeah, you certainly don't want to use the mode of the drain mode on it.
If Nas draws a fetch land that can give +3 to both shadows, and they both be attacking for 6, a Teemer Battle Rage actually makes that lethal, assuming nothing else is happening.
Yeah, so pressure is on Brendan to kill these last two shadows. If he can, he probably walks away with the game. Mm-hmm. But Matt's not going to give him too much time to do it. So Brendan will continue. He is successfully Thought Seized the Kolaghan's Command. Abrupt Decay the first threat. It's a Tarmogoyf. You see Collective Brutality in Brendan's hands. Not. Yeah, he'll go ahead and make Matt discard that. And actually, this is interesting. He's going to -2/-2 the Death Shadow twice, leaving Matt a turn to have that Teemer Battle Rage work.
The odds that Nass can actually make this lethal on this turn. It would involve something like running Street Race, especially now like a Taxium Probe is banned. That's a very low percentage thing. And I believe that Johnson's last card is Abrupt Decay.
Yeah, I was wondering if Matt was just going to use the Battle Rage as a Lava Spike. It looks like he can't do that. Brendan will cast Lingering Souls.
That makes some blockers. Nass is able to lose another point of life. It won't stop this Death Shadow from trampling.
Yeah, the Abrupt Decay in Brendan's hand will be down for at least one more turn. Two 1-1s into play. Brendan passes.
And he is still representing Fatal Push, which has to give Nass some pause about going for a Battle Rage on this turn.
Then we start getting the question right of, if he has Fatal Push, can Matt win anyway?
Right.
He might just play into the card.
Yeah, you pretty much have to.
If he draws another threat, he might not have to, but that's about it. We do sense that Matt will just Fatal Push away a Spirit Token. And to draw. Thoughtseize. So now he gets to have good information, and that's a big Thoughtseize.
That's a huge pickup. Not only does it make the Death Shadow larger, but it takes Abrupt Decay out of the hand.
Well, and it takes the win.
How about making a Death Shadow lethal with the Battle Rage?
Yeah, so Thoughtseize would put Matt down to 6. The Death Shadow would be up to a 7-7. Teamer Battle Rage makes 14 damage. Trampling, only one blocker, Brendan at 12. That Thoughtseize is a lethal draw, and it actually is Matt Nass winning the first game with Death Shadow.
Yeah, able to squeak that one out.
I'll admit, I'm surprised to see him get the first game there, but now that he's up a game, what a win for Matthew Nass.
Had Johnson used Collective Brutality to take Teamer Battle Rage and Abrupt Decay to kill a Death Shadow, we might have seen a different game. It makes his Collective Brutality less effective.
Yeah, I think what he was trying to do is he was thinking, if he can kill all Matt's creatures, he wins. So yes, he'll accept the 2-for-1. You know, he just needed to survive one turn there. I kind of like how Brendan played it. That Thoughtseize draw just hurt him so bad. I mean, it lost him the game. Mm-hmm. But say Matt draws a land there, right? Brendan wins.
Right.
So we're going to go ahead and look at the sideboards here quickly for both players.
Sure. On Johnston's side, we have 3 Fulminator Mage, 2 Gideon Ally of Zendikar, 2 Stony Silence, a Grafdigger's Cage, a Nihil Spellbomb, an Engineered Explosives, a Scavenging Ooze, a Damnation, a Liliana of the Last Hope, a Collective Brutality, and a Surgical Extraction. Big hits here are going to be the Engineered Explosives, which can clean up even multiple Death Shadows. Damnation also for the same reason, just more removal spells. Those cards both seem excellent here. You could bring it in Gideon and just really make a grindy approach to this matchup, which I like a decent amount. But primarily, we're looking at these sweeper effects, the explosives and the damnation.
It's just any sort of removal, right? As long as he can, once he kills Matt's threats, he should be good.
You can even bring in Fulminator Mage to really just choke Nass out. His deck is light enough on lands.
So now on Matt Nass's side, he actually has interesting cards of his own. He has his own copies of Lingering Souls, cards like that, Liliana of the Veil. He can kind of take Brendan's strategy.
Yeah, looks like his plan is going to involve trying to go on the same kind of scale as the other Abzan deck. So he's going to bring in Ranger of Eos, which generates card advantage. Lingering Souls for much the same reason. And we could see Fulminator Mages on both sides here. These are decks that play a lot of non-basic lands that really use a lot of their mana every turn. So Fulminator Mages is solid on either side.
All right, so thanks for joining us this weekend. We're in Baltimore. This is our first team stop on the SCG Tour, but we have a lot more events coming up. So next weekend, we'll be over in Indianapolis for our first Modern Open of 2017. We're not going to stop there. A couple weeks later, we'll be in Dallas to play Modern, and then we'll be back over here on the East Coast in April for the Legacy Open of Season 1. That's going to be April 8th and 9th. It's in Worcester, Massachusetts. Make sure to sign up for that one. Space is limited, and those ones do tend to sell out.
Yes.
Also, though, we have some standard opens then coming up in April, one in Atlanta. Then we have in May, we'll go to Louisville before concluding the season with Modern Opens both back here in Baltimore and in Charlotte before our Season 1 Invitational. That's June 30th through July 2nd in Roanoke, Virginia. It's going to be both Modern and Standard.
It'll be our first Invitational in Roanoke. Really excited for that tournament. It's going to be a sweet one. You're going to want to qualify and be there for sure. Bunch of great stops on the way as well. So go ahead and get your qualification, and we'll see you in Roanoke.
All right. We do have playmats to give away, too. This is for the Opens and Classics. The standard one, hey, it's a standard legal playmat, first of all.
Nice.
It is the copy of Aether Hub. I don't think this one's going to get banned.
I hope not. That'd be weird. That'd be very, very weird.
Now giving that away with standard opens, which means kind of the smugglest copper is now a vintage playmat, right? It was a just a small window. We have for Modern, it's the invention artwork of Aether Vial. So you have an Aether Hub and an Aether Vial, which means in Legacy we're going to have
Aether Gamble.
Yeah, we'll call it that. Aether Gamble, that one's given away for Legacy opens and Classics. So you can get these playmats with entry to the Season 1, any opener Classic in Season 1. Other ways to get it also, their infinite challenges. We'll talk about that later. But these will be available from now through the end of June.
A lot of great art. Love the Kaladesh-style guide here. And we see players are underway for Game 2 here. It's like Johnson is resolving an Inquisition of Kozilek.
All right, yeah, we'll get this one already underway. So, Nass on the play. We see... Actually, oh, sorry, on the draw. So turn one, Inquisition from Brendan. Nass's hand is two lands. Tarmogoyf, Thoughtseize, Thoughtseize, Traverse, Mishra's Bauble. So that takes the only threat out of his hand.
Yes and no. Nass has access to Thoughtseize, Mishra's Bauble, fetch land, and a creature in his graveyard, so that Traverse can already be converted into a threat.
Turn one, Thoughtseize. Turn two, Traverse, can find a creature. Yeah, he'll have Delirium that quickly. Mm-hmm. Four copies of Traverse in the Death Shadow deck. It's one of the ways they get to cheat on threats.
Yeah, it's not that difficult to turn this card into Elidamri's Call in this deck. Mishra's Bauble.
Ten points if people watching just immediately knew Elidamri's Call.
All the Commander players knew it.
Oh, yeah.
I can tell you that much. That card is not cheap.
If you play Omnitel in Legacy, you probably know it, too.
You might know that one.
Thoughtseize from Matt Nass. Now we get to look at the Abzan hand, which is a second land, another discard spell, Dark Confidant, Liliana, and Lingering Souls. A pretty good layout for the Abzan player.
Yeah.
What I'm wondering, do you have to take the Inquisition? If you don't, he'll take your Traverse.
Yeah, that certainly impedes Nass. You can't just let Dark Confidant go unchecked, though.
Right. So that's, I mean, we're looking at one of those two, but my question is, which one?
I'm definitely leaning Confidant here. We'll see what happens. Just the fact that it can generate card advantage, you know, even if Nass is able to retain one threat, the Confidant just generates a stream of cards off the top.
Remember, there, Math Nass's hand has... another Thoughtseize in it, a Traverse the Open Vault as his only threat, or it was until his draw step, where it looks like he's picked up Death's Shadow, so that might make this decision easier.
Yeah. It's likely that the Inquisition on Johnson's side is actually going to be looking for Nass's Thoughtseize, which will then allow Johnson to have an unchecked Liliana of the Veil. He does need to produce another land to make that happen, but that Liliana is really scary against a hand that's threat light.
Over in Standard, Ben Stark playing Black-Green Delirium does pick up the win in Game 1 over Trevor Beckman. So now two matches are in the favor of Stark, Nass, and Pardee.
And the most problematic matchup that's happening here is likely the Legacy matchup for Stark, Nass, and Pardee. The Death and Taxes deck is quite good at checking these three-color mana bases.
Matt Wilt ends up taking the Dark Confidant, uses Bauble to see that his opponent's about to draw Windswept Heath, and it will be then Inquisition from Brendan. And you see he just immediately takes the Thoughtseize, leaving with Traverse and Death's Shadow. I suppose if Matt plays a creature, Brendan has a very good follow-up in land Liliana minus two.
Right.
As long as the cards continue to trade, Brendan will win.
Right.
Matt draws a card there off of the Bauble, draws for turn. He picks up Planeswalker of his own. It's also Liliana. His is the last hope.
That one's going to be good at combating Liliana of the Veil, as it can minus two and get creatures back for Nass.
So Matt will move forward, goes down to 13, can traverse for a card. Now, it down to 13 means he can't actually cast Death's Shadow just yet. It would be a 0-0. He would love to be at 12.
Could do something like traverse for Street Wraith, cycle that, and then cast it.
Interesting. Yeah, that would be a way to get it into play. Though it does mean he's not turning his traverse into a threat. So We'll see what Matt decides to do here.
If you cycle Street Wraith, you could get anything. Even another Street Wraith.
Yeah, you could cycle Street Wraith into the card you were hoping to tutor for, and then it's just great.
Yeah.
And it looks like he's going to make that play. It's one of the more I like about this Death Shadow deck is, well, you have a tutor effect. What are you going to tutor for? I'm going to tutor for a way to punch myself for two.
He's pulled three cards at the front. He has Ranger of Eos, Renegade Rallier, and that Street Wraith, the aforementioned Street Wraith. Rallier is going to be a little difficult to execute through Liliana. He'll need another fetch land to make that happen. His deck does have a lot of fetch lands, though. He has a Mishra's Bauble in hand currently, I believe. He already used that one, so he has to produce something that can trigger that. But that card is very powerful, certainly against Liliana of the Veil.
So he's going
to
select Renegade Rallier. This is an inclusion from Kaladesh. This is the 3-2 for 3. When it enters the battlefield, if he revolted, if a permanent left the battlefield, he can return a permanent with converted mana cost 2 or less from his graveyard to battlefield. So ideally, he'd crack a fetch land, cast this, get back something else.
Yep. He's had that Tarmogoyf in his graveyard for a minute.
Yeah, that sounds great. And Matt didn't really want to cast a creature. I think what was the decider about the Street Wraith is if he did the Street Wraith play, he'd be casting a Death Shadow into a Liliana he already knows about. Mm-hmm. That's not exciting.
Right. And if he's able to execute the Rallier, get back the Tarmogoyf, and he has that Rallier that insulates him against the Liliana, sacrificing the 3-2, that's just fine.
So it will be Liliana from Brendan Johnson. He'll plus it to make both players discard. Matt will get rid of his Death Shadow.
Currently a 0-0. That makes a lot of sense.
Draws for turn. Now, he does have a third land. It is not a fetch land, though, and that's kind of a bad beat for Matt Nass.
This one's not bad, though.
His own Liliana. Yeah, if he had a fetch land, that would trigger Revolt for his Rallier. But his own Liliana, so now both of them will go to work. Minus 2 from Matt Nass. Mills himself and gets a creature back. And now Matt's kind of playing a value game, too. You see he flips Lingering Souls into his graveyard.
That was a really good hit there. And now can get back either Death Shadow or Tarmogoyf.
Or he flipped a Street Wraith, too. That one's not as exciting as the others.
If cycling triggered a rally, I might be interested in that one. Assuming that there's no creatures trading back and forth otherwise, Liliana the Last Hope can generate value that combats Liliana of the Veil quite nicely.
Inquisition of Kozlek from Brendan Johnson. He'll get a look at Nass's hand. It is Rallier, Street Wraith, and Inquisition.
Get that Rallier out of there.
Yeah. Plus Liliana for Johnson's last card, which is Lingering Souls, and he'll flash it back.
And he still has that other one in his graveyard as well.
Now, Lingering Souls actually, Ryan, doesn't position very well against Matt's Liliana, though.
No, it just gets to plus one and kill one of the spirits.
So, Brendan Johnson empty-handed. Matt Nass basically empty-handed.
Nass picked up the fetch land this turn, which is very unfortunate for him.
Now, kills a spirit token. Makes his own Lingering Souls. You know, in this Liliana fight, I like Matt Nass's Liliana more.
Yes. Yeah, using Liliana of the Veil to minus two to kill a spirit token is not a very exciting trade.
And the top deck fight will begin. Right now, it looks like Matt Nass is advantaged. The longer this goes on, the more I would expect Brendan's deck to pull away. You know, cards like Grim Flayer, Grim Flayer, Scavenging Ooze.
Yeah, Dark Confidant does not line up very well against Liliana the Last Hope. But any of these larger creatures, more Lingering Souls, that'd be good for Johnson.
Team of Stark, Nass, and Pardee up a game both in Standard and Modern. The Legacy match between Paul Espina and Sam Pardee actually still in game one. You see for Brendan, the draw was Collective Brutality. So he traded a Lingering Souls token. Brutality to another one, plus to Liliana, and passed the turn. At six, his Liliana could ultimate and maybe threaten to kill Matt's Liliana.
It's a good chance that Johnson will wait until he at least has seven loyalty on his Liliana so that he can keep that one around, depending what Nass is able to produce in the interim.
Interesting. Now, looks like Matt is going to not do, is going to abandon the Planeswalker fight. He's going to minus two his own Planeswalker. That will send it to the graveyard. Flips two over. It does mean he can get back the Rallier. Liliana left the battlefield, so Revolt is online. Matt's last card was a fetch land, so he'll play it. Yeah, cast Rallier. This is an interesting line from Matt. It's going to have a lot of size on in play. Gets back Death Shadow. Now, Ryan, I'm a little surprised on this one because there's still a Lingering Souls in Brendan's graveyard. It just seems like Brendan has such a clean response to this. Minus two Liliana, make some chump blockers, minus two Liliana.
Just Nast just doesn't have a lot of other options.
The other play wasn't any better.
Yeah. Just letting your Planeswalker get eaten by the Liliana ultimate or, you know, one-sided Armageddon. That's not a great spot to be in either.
Well, what is a great spot to be in is now where the team of Stark, Nass, and Pardee is. Game one in Legacy does finish, and now all three games have gone, matches have gone the same way. Sam Pardee with Sultai Control takes the first game.
All right, just two more games, and that team will pull away with the match.
Tarmogoyf tries to take down the Planeswalker, but Brendan says no. Lingering Souls jumps in the way. We go to Brendan's turn. Liliana eats the Tarmogoyf now, too. And Brendan looks to have successfully traded this away. His now has a Scavenging Ooze as a follow-up. And between the Ooze and the Liliana, that should be able to beat Matt's top decks.
Yep.
Fatal Push gets will take care of Scavenging Ooze, but not before Brendan eats away a card in Matt's graveyard.
So now that Nass has exhausted his Liliana, the Last Hope, and Renegade Rallier, not a ton he can do with his graveyard anymore anyway.
And the top of his deck did not help. It was a fetch land. And this gives Brendan a turn to start ticking his Liliana back up again. He's just waiting for another threat.
Nass's deck does feature a pair of Kolaghan's Command, which would have been a great top deck on the previous turn.
Right. He needed it right then, though.
Right. And now with the Liliana going up to three loyalty, that changes the equation.
Brendan has a bit of a decision. He drew Maelstrom Pulse for the turn. And I think he wants to keep that card in hand, and he also wants to plus his Liliana. You see him now deciding.
This extends the window for a strong Kolaghan's Command.
Yeah, discard and deal two. Yeah. If you're playing around Lingering Souls, this Pulse is really good. If you're trying to beat a Tarmogoyf, I don't know. It depends what he wants to beat, right? Mm-hmm. He now knows Matt Nass has Lingering Souls. So this Pulse does work.
Well, Pulse beats Tarmogoyf just the same. Less efficient of a trade.
Yeah, it looks like Brendan decides not to tick up the Planeswalker. He'll just hang on to his removal spell. And did Matt find Lingering Souls? No, but he found Liliana of the Veil. Which, you can't, there is a world where he'd be able to pulse it, but not this one, because Liliana makes him discard the card.
Destroying both Lilianas is not the most exciting use of Maelstrom Pulse either.
Oh, you're right. It does hit. It would hit his own, wouldn't it? Fatal Push the draw from Brendan, so he'll just tick up his own Liliana and discard that. Matt Nass is down to seven. At some point, he may have to pull the trigger on minus two-ing to kill the spirit token.
And currently no creature lands, no shambling events or anything like that for Johnson, so Liliana can pretty safely minus two if Nass desires to do so.
Matt's going to go to six for a fetch land. And then hard cast Street Wraith. And minus two is Liliana.
You don't see that one a lot.
You know, you were saying that didn't count as a creature when I was counting his threats. Well, let me tell you.
It's about to hit the bin.
Yeah, I guess it okay, now it doesn't count anymore. Liliana takes care of it. But for a brief second.
It did demand an answer. It does have Swamp Walk, too.
Would have been nice. If it stayed alive, it would have been a great card.
Yeah,
no doubt about it.
You can't just not kill that one with Liliana of the Veil.
So now players are going to go back and forth, plussing their Planeswalkers, but when Matt goes to plus his Liliana, Brendan is at the ready with an Abrupt Decay. So Matt loses that and then discards his Dismember. And here's Gideon. Yeah.
This is a lot more powerful than Street Wraith.
This is why Abzan is favored in the top deck war. Eventually, Brendan's going to draw something like this.
Yeah, Gideon is a card that certainly made his presence known in Standard time and again, but it's actually very powerful even in Modern. This is probably in the top three Planeswalkers ever printed.
There's no way Matt's coming back from that. You see him stacking up the cards. So the team of Beckman, Johnson, and Espina gets their first win. It's in Modern, and the Abzan player evens the score at one game apiece. And that's more the pacing I expected this game to have happen. You know, trade, empty hands, Obs on top deck, something better than Death Shadow. Mm-hmm.
And Nass is able to generate a little bit more value as we go into the sideboard game. We saw he had the options with Ranger of Eos, with Renegade Rallyer. He can generate some value.
I did like that. You know, you saw Matt play his both copies of Liliana, Traverse for Renegade Rallyer. He put up, as far as that, like, Jundi game plan of trading, Matt did a much better fight than I've seen Death's previous versions of Death Shadow do.
And had he had the fetch land the turn after he traversed for Rallyer, we could
have won.
A very different game, yeah.
So, and this is, I think, some of the appeal of these new Death Shadow Jund is that it does do a fair game plan somewhat reasonably.
Yes. Turns out access to four tutors really influences the way that you're able to play the game.
Yeah. So those players are going to get it ready for a third game. So now that we are into Season 1, we just told you about the schedule of it. We also now have the new energy token. This is Jacob Baugh's token, which he got for winning the Season 3 Invitational last year. He was the champion in Atlanta, did it with the Aetherworks Marvel deck, and had his likeness made on the energy counter. So this is now being given away at all Opens and Classics on the SCG Tour. So it's going to be, it started in January, and we'll be giving these away all the way through the end of June. Also, if you can't make it out to one of our events, it ships in orders from StarCityGames.com of at least $5. So you can get your hands on one of these for all of Season 1.
Baugh demonstrating a spirit bomb here. You see the polar bears of the Earth giving him their energy. Polar bears, of course, being Earth's most energetic animals, as has been established on previous broadcasts.
Well, it's because they eat so much, or they just have some, you know, so much reserves.
Yeah, you have to have a lot of energy to effectively hibernate. Right. Sometimes I sleep for 10, 12 hours.
You're hibernating.
It's more for the lack of energy when I do it.
Oh, okay.
A polar bear would certainly outdo me in any kind of physical bout.
Well, if it involved staying warm longer, I would think so.
Oh, very easily.
Game number 3 underway. Matt Nass on the play. Starts with Street Wraith, and you kind of see those value cards shaping up, both Lingering Souls and Ranger of Eos in the opening hand. If he can stop Ranger, if Ranger can somehow make it through all the discard spells, it'll be a really good play.
If it's all Inquisitions and no Thought Seizes, Ranger is massive. Nass does have to make 4 land drops, but...
Yeah, he has Renegade Rallyer as well, so a lot of his value cards.
Yeah.
Though even with something like Rallyer, Ranger, and Lingering Souls, outvaluing the Abzan deck is tough business.
It's difficult.
So Nass's play is a turn 1 Traverse for a basic Swamp. So he did that off of Stomping Ground, so his mana should be set. At least in colors. We'll see if he has enough lands. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it looks like we're going to get a look at Nass's hand. It is going to be Inquisition of Kozilek from Brendan Johnson. And we see Collective Brutality, Renegade Rallyer, Lingering Souls, Ranger of Eos, and then lands number 2 and 3. Kind of feels like a Jund mirror right now.
The Lingering Souls and the Ranger of Eos have different kinds of sort of protection from Inquisition of Kozilek. The Ranger just too expensive to hit. The Lingering Souls with the flashback.
So Ryan, do you take Renegade Rallyer? It's a 2-for-1 in theory, but there are no 2-drops in Nass's graveyard.
Depends how weak my hand is to Collective Brutality.
All right. Brendan takes Brutality. So maybe he's protecting a Dark Confidant, say, right? Matt has no removal.
Something that the Rallyer already does is it gets any permanent, so it can recur a fetch land.
Oh, it's any permanent. Okay.
And that gets Nass up to 4 mana to cast Ranger of Eos.
Yeah, and Matt just keeps drawing Jund cards. Kolaghan's Command is his draw for the turn.
It's not a bad one.
No, this is really interesting because he's just doing a value plan.
And if Johnson is concerned about Collective Brutality, that signals to me he has something like a Dark Confidant in his hand.
If he's concerned about brutality, then Colgan's Command is also a card that he would be concerned about.
Very likely.
Gavinny Township, scavenging ooze for Brendan Johnson. Was hoping to protect this one. Not going to work. Well, here's an interesting one. Matt's only other land is a fetch land. Mm-hmm. And if he plays fetch land and cracks it for Colgan's Command right now, then his Renegade Rallier's off.
And Ness isn't necessarily overly concerned about scavenging ooze. If it was a Dark Confidant, I'd be much more inclined to go ahead, Colgan's Command, take care of that one. The scavenging ooze, he can end up outsizing. He gets Ranger down, loses some more life, makes a couple Death Shadows. The scavenging ooze can turn into something of a non-issue.
Some rallying from the team of Beckman, Johnson, and Espina. Beckman takes a game in Standard with Bant Marvel. He evens the games with Ben Stark.
Making it interesting. The longer that the Legacy match is happening here between Espina and Pardy, the more I think it's going to favor the Sultai control deck. The Death and Taxes deck is trying to pressure the mana and win faster games.
And so Matt Nass, despite having the option for the other plays you're mentioning, he goes just for Colgan's Command. He's paying a lot of respect to Scavenging Ooze, and he's going to kill the Ooze and buy back his Street Wraith.
Destroy your creature, draw a card. Not a bad exchange.
If it's a value matchup, it's what you want to be doing.
A veritable Electrolyze.
Tarmogoyf, the play from Brendan Johnson. Creature, sorcery, instant, land. Looks like a 4-5. Matt Nass draws a Tarmogoyf of his own. Cycle Street Wraith. As was the fear, he doesn't have a land just yet. Can he cycle into it? The answer is no.
I picked up Lingering Souls there, which is a fine draw.
Yeah, he doesn't have the land yet, but he has a lot of ways to make time. He'll start with Inquisition of Kozilek.
Ooh.
Three lands and a Liliana. That's a big hit for Matt.
Huge win for Nass here. His hand is full of gas.
Plays his own Tarmogoyf, so the board is even. Yeah, this is a big danger for Brendan Johnson.
What Johnson really wants to see off the top right now is Gideon.
That would be a game changer for sure.
We see Johnson's going to go to his turn. Three lands in his hand, three lands on the battlefield.
If
just a Tarmogoyf otherwise.
Gideon would be huge. Got Godless Shrine for the turn. Now, when he gets to land five, he does actually have Gavinny Township in play. So start by decaying away the Tarmogoyf and attacking for four. And keep in mind, Matt's deck deals a lot of damage to itself. He's actually, I believe, at 10. Maybe even less. That was a 5. The Goyf's a 5-6.
And Nass still missing on that fourth land drop.
He was at 10 before the attack. Matt's actually at 5.
He can make some chump blockers with that Lingering Souls, and he knows that Johnson is out. Johnson just has two lands in hand.
One match in the books. So while Trevor Beckman and Brendan Johnson were able to force game three, Paul Espina was not. Sam Pardee on Sultai control, a clean winner, 2-0. You see, he now moves over to the Matt Nass game. Matt's looking to be in a tough spot. It might come down to Ben Stark to take this one.
Johnson's going to need to peel some spells to actually close this game.
Yeah, Lingering Souls from Matt Nass. One of them chump blocks the Tarmogoyf. And here's a good one. How about another Tarmogoyf from Brendan? Two lethal attackers. Sounds pretty great.
Nass could produce some Death Shadows. They would be larger than Tarmogoyf.
He'll use Mishra's Bauble. That triggers Revolt.
Turns on the Rallier.
Is there a Death Shadow in his yard, though?
He has his own Tarmogoyf, which is good.
Yeah, because a Spirit Token plus Tarmogoyf kills a Tarmogoyf. Well,
he needs Spirit Token, he needs Rallier Tarmogoyf because of this Gavinny Township.
Gosh, because we have a Tarmogoyf mirror, this Township is really good.
Anything that can do one more in these Tarmogoyf mirrors just breaks it open.
This is not the kind of match. I guess Gavinny Township is one of those cards that you never think it matters in Obzon until, I don't know, it's like sneakily powerful.
It's one of those things where you have some number of outs, and Gavinny Township makes that number smaller, and you really feel that in a game like this.
So Matt decides to go for another copy of Lingering Souls then instead of the Renegade Rallier. Upkeep draws off the Bauble. He did hit land four. So, two chump blocks on the spirit tokens. Brendan, his draw is not something he wanted to play, so we go back to Matt Nass.
Well, once Nass can Ranger and find those Death Shadows, it's going to take a while for that Township to pull ahead of that.
Well, and there's a lot going on here. So Matt has Fetchland, Fatal Push, Renegade, Rallier. He could do all of them this turn.
That would be a big exchange. Yeah, Nass is that traditional thing where you see flooding on lands versus stalling on lands. If you stall on lands and survive long enough, you can pull ahead.
Well, we mentioned that earlier, right? Matt had so many good cards for an attrition match. He just needed to buy himself time to cast them all. And it's looking like he might be able to do it here. Mm-hmm. One question would be, how low is he going to go on this fetch? Is it four or is it two?
Doesn't have to worry about a burn spell.
Yeah, this is Abzan, not Jund. Mm-hmm.
And with the Tarmogoyfs being lethal from five, it's not a ton that could go wrong that matters, where the difference between five and two makes any difference.
Lingering Souls would now, he went to two, so now doesn't Lingering Souls become scary? Brendan could make four guys, say go, and the next turn township them all.
Going down to four already makes that lethal in one turn.
Okay, so might as well go, sure. We're already losing to that card, let's not play around it.
Right.
So, Renegade Rallier, triggers Revolt, gets Tarmogoyf. And Fatal Push in Matt Nass's hand. He's got the board under control right now. Johnson will use his township. However, and then he'll Fatal Push the Tarmogoyf. This does make Collective Brutality an out.
True.
Swings with both creatures. Because he had the Fatal Push for the Tarmogoyf, Matt does not have the board stabilized yet. He's going to block both and then fatally push away one of the Tarmogoyfs. Just a pass from Brendan. I think Matt very happy that nothing like Gideon happened there.
Yes.
Matt draws a Death Shadow. He's got some Lingering Souls in his graveyard, too. Death Shadow currently in 11-11. That's going to be big enough to tangle with any Tarmogoyf. And he'll swing the Rallier, flashback Lingering Souls, and cast Death Shadow. And now the board has been stabilized from Matt.
It looks like Johnson has two more lands in his hand.
That's not going to do anything for him. Plays Shambling Vent, passes.
There are worse lands. Certainly would rather have a spell.
And there's blockers aplenty here. Matt draws another Death Shadow. I was going to say there's another Lingering Souls in Matt's yard. So I think he can just make that same play again.
Now Nass is firmly in the driver's seat.
A swing with, you can tell when both the spirit tokens are swinging too. That's a big sign of strength.
Yeah, Johnson's kind of in brutality or bust range here.
He'll go to three on this attack. Another Death Shadow from Matt. Two more souls. Can Brendan draw the brutality?
Damnation would also be a big pickup.
Sure. With the speed he's playing here, I'm not sure he has either.
Not looking like it.
And Matt Nass looks like he's able to outgrind the Abzan deck. Made this one interesting, though. This got really close.
Yes. And this matchup basically is going to come down to a lot of trading of removal spells. And where Nass was really able to pull this out, not just, having Lingering Soul's advantage was huge, but the fact that Death Shadow at the end of the day, sticking one of those just matters more than sticking a Tarmogoyf.
Swing in the air. And Brendan, no answers. So Matt Nass with Death Shadow takes the third game, and with it, his team wins the round. So the team of Stark, Nass, and Pardee off to a 3-0 start to the tournament.
Yeah, I don't think anybody would have put them much below that going in. Certainly a very strong team win this event.
You might get a game off them, but getting two looks to be a very difficult task. The team of Beckman and Johnson Espina got a couple games, but was not even able to get a match.